Welcome back. Our guest on this episode is a multiple award-winning medical doctor, TEDx speaker, health influencer, and global advocate for women and girl child empowerment. Through her non-profit organization called He for Africa Initiative, she's advancing the lives of women and girls through health, education, and socioeconomic empowerment while advocating for a sustainable livelihood and gender equality for females across Africa. She's a physician at the State Government House Clinic in Lokoja, Kogi, and a happy-go-lucky doctor behind the online personal health attainer. That brand is to promote preventive health and wellness across all social media platforms. Let's make welcome the ever-smiling Dr. Kelechi Okoro.
Okay.
At least you're smiling.
Yes, but what if I wasn't smiling?
I know you will smile. How is it going?
Well, I'm fine. Aside the Lagos traffic that almost ruined my day, I'm fine.
Okay, so mixing health and entertainment. How did you come about that idea?
Okay, do you want the long story or the short story?
We're ready for anyone.
You're ready for me, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, I was a student. Of course, everybody was a student. And then I was just the backbencher and then the person who doesn't like the whole serious stuff. And I had lecturers who were really serious. And then it was hard to grasp what they were saying. But there were lecturers who were very funny, and then they were happy-go-lucky, and, you know, and it was just easier to understand. For example, when you go to a clinic and then you see a doctor like me, what happens? What happens? I want you to answer.
I was just wondering, man, sick. So you...
No, the reverse. Like, you know,
you get better.
Okay, so I just felt that it was easier, and, you know, when I listened to lecturers who were less serious and had some humor to whatever they were doing. Okay, fast forward to when I left medical school. And then I'm just my goofy self most of the time. And I realized that patients or whoever I'm talking to, they just understand me better when I'm just me and I'm just smiling and I'm just making everything relatable and not so, you know, in medicine they call it highfalutin. For example, you want to tell someone that they have shortage of blood and you're saying, Madam, you have anemia. Do you know what anemia means?
Mm-mm.
No. So I just decided that, okay, I had to make it relatable and then, you know, and then I was thinking, I'm coming to social media and then what's the demography on social media? The Malians, the people who like Naira Marley, the people who like Zlatan, the people who like Wizkid, the hippie people. And then I'm not so young, but I know I'm still hippie, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, okay, how do I make medicine or healthcare, you know, health education nice and then interesting for these people to want to hear, and I realized I had to be like them. Of course, I was like them offline, but you know, most of the time you want to say something and you just bring that doctor
medical
in you
terms.
And then you start, you know, being serious. I just decided, okay, I have to fuse some entertainment into it, and then I just started like that, making it relatable, making it interesting, going with trends, basically. Most of the things I talk about on social media are social health issues.
Mm-hmm.
For example, all of a sudden they're talking about somebody who is smelling on the reality TV show, and then I'm keen into that trend to tell you how to, you know, have proper hygiene, and then how girls
how
can...
How to smell bad.
Yes, you know, all
okay,
of that.
How acceptable would you say the brand was initially, considering your medical doctors, you know,
okay,
how uptight they can be,
okay,
especially the ones that have been there for a long time. Did they take your craft seriously?
Okay, now, the people I was servicing, they took my craft, like, they were excited, oh, this is new. And then there was this time, you know, Nedu was BIFM. He does this in Nkechi here again. That was the first time I went viral. And I did an impression of Nedu was BIFM, but I taught people about safe sex, how to use protection, and if they don't use protection, they tend to get hepatitis, HIV, and the likes. But I did it like an already known comedian, and I went viral, and, you know, the message was there, but people were laughing, and then they were getting the message. So for my target audience, it was exciting. But for the other doctors, I mean, most of us, we are stereotypical. We just believe that everything should be done the conventional way.
Mm-hmm.
But I am a rebel.
Mm-hmm.
I am an outlier. When I want to do something and I think that, and I think about the end result, I just go for it.
Okay.
Of course, there were some eyes like, okay, what is she doing? Why is she not trying to be serious? Medicine's the serious stuff. But eventually, people just caught on, and I have people actually trying to do the same thing that I'm doing, and I'm actually doing it successfully. You know a lot of them now. So I have been able to, you know, flourish in my niche. Of course, when I came on social media, there was nobody doing what I was doing. So it was hard. I remember I had to reach out to conventional influencers to, you know, help me, you know, get the visibility I wanted. And then everybody just caught on eventually. Mm-hmm. So I had other doctors. In fact, there's my lecturer in school. He called me up and he was like, I like what you're doing. And I remember vividly one time we were in class and he said, because this is how I've always been in medical school. And he's like, what are you doing in medicine? You're supposed to be in entertainment. And I'm like, I'm going to do the two of them.
Okay.
And he said, oh, you actually did what you said you were going to do. And at the time I said it, I wasn't thinking, and I just said it.
Yeah,
but okay. Here I am. Yeah, I had no clue. But, you know, when you have to do something, a sister has to do what a sister has to do. Okay, so here we are.
There's another part to you about girl empowerment, youth empowerment. Tell us about that, and what is that in specific?
Okay, so I was getting a lot of buzz on social media, and then I had these critics who say, the people who need to hear these things are not on social media. The people who, all these people, they already know these things, they can Google these things, and they can get the information that they want. And of course, I knew that also. So I knew that I had to service another, you know, subset of people. And I'm this person who likes the grassroots. I like to interact, you know, with less privileged. I like to interact with people who do not have the advantage that I have to have access to social media. And then I was posted to Kogi in 2016. And then I had, you know, the platform to actually reach out to girls in secondary schools, girls in the rural areas. And I'm like, okay, why don't I start something whilst I am doing the online advocacy? Then I should also go into the communities and do that. So I found I and two other doctors who are not currently in the country. Hopefully when they are in the country, then everybody gets to know them. But we founded that organization, and then we started the Pay Attention to Her project, where we go to secondary schools and talk to girls about menstrual hygiene. We talk to them about female health. And then we go past that to actually empower them mentally, emotionally. And then we are still moving forward to trying to teach them how to be financially, you know, independent. There's a whole lot, but we have to start really small. Okay? So we started with menstrual hygiene. And then we just go in.
For these young girls, would you say the gap is really in poverty or what the older generation have got to pass down to them?
Okay. It's not just it's multifaceted, actually.
Okay.
The poverty is there. Mm-hmm. But we have a lot of rich people who do not even know these things.
Mm-hmm.
But first off, poverty is a problem. And then the society, for example, I talk about menstrual hygiene a lot. And then people are like, when I'm on my period, I say it, I'm on my period, I'm having menstrual pain, and people are like, shh.
Don't talk about it.
Mm-hmm. But this thing is real. A lot of girls, a lot of women, a lot of young girls like you and I, and even older women, they go through a lot of menstrual problems and they dare not ask even their doctors because they feel like it's a societal thing. There's social restrictions, cultural restrictions. These things are not supposed to be talked about. But women are dying inside.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So there's that gap where also, you know, the norm over time, societal norms, we shouldn't talk about these things, and then these girls do not even know, they don't get that information.
Mm-hmm.
So that's also a problem.
Okay, so you said something earlier about people saying, the people you're talking to online, they understand these things, they can Google it. But some will tell you that when you Google, it's not 100% sure that you're getting the right thing. So would you say you've been able to break this thing down on social media, even to those who feel they are not? Because there's a problem when you think you know and you do not know. Do you think we're getting the results you hope for? And how important is health or are health influencers for our development?
Okay, first off, mm-hmm. before we, the health influencers in quotes, came on board, we had people talking about health. People who had no business talking about health.
Okay.
Okay, so, and that was really one of the reasons why I had to come in, because I'm like, these people are not doctors, but a lot of doctors are busy. Our 9-to-5 can be really hectic.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't even have that time to go on social media. And when we go on social media, we just want to de-stress, we just want to unwind and then just, you know, go with the flow. But having actual doctors now come on social media and break these things down. The likes of Aproko Doctor, the likes of Dr. Zobo, the likes of Stardoc, the likes of SpotDoc, there are a lot of them, Debo. People now have an authentic, you know, place to go and seek for health, you know, health information. And yes, we are gradually, how did I forget Olufemilayo? Mm-hmm. Okay, so we are gradually breaking, you know, that, we are bridging that gap where if you need health information, mm-hmm. then you know the right handles to go to. We have people who are not even doctors and they just write Dr. Something. I was about to call someone, but I won't.
Looking at the health space, okay. right, and the problems doctors will come out to say they have, especially the younger ones coming in, not being able to get their housemanship and all that. Okay. What would you say digital media has done to help them have a voice and to actually make a living?
Money.
Okay. In
yes,
what
there was this time I made like 1 million naira in a week okay. on social media. First off, let me shout out to all the influencers that have helped me on my journey, including Elsie Isi. Mm-hmm. I never knew her before. I met her on social media, and she was one of the people who helped push my brand. Thank you. Okay, so for people, you know, practicing medicine in Nigeria is not. I'm glowing because I'm doing other
it's
things.
It's not financially rewarding?
Oh, well, we all know it's not.
Okay.
It's really hectic. A lot of doctors, especially in Lagos, have to work two jobs. In fact, I would not call the hospital. There are a lot of hospitals in Lagos that pay medical doctors, medical officers. Okay, first off, when you're doing your housemanship, sometimes that's like the most money you would ever see as a medical officer, because the government is paying you between 150 and 190. And then you're working in that hospital, you finish your housemanship in that hospital, and then they take you as a medical officer and they pay you 50,000 naira.
So you're coming down from 150,000 naira to 50,000
yes.
naira?
Yes. Some people come from 190 to 50, 70. So you see a lot of doctors, they have to do morning shifts in somewhere, do evening shifts somewhere, and then do weekend calls. Me, I like to turn up. I don't think that. And then my mental health is really important to me. Mm-hmm. Everybody has their limits, I mean. So having to subject a doctor to such hours of work, you're not doing the patient any good. Sometimes they are too tired to, you know, give proper health care. Okay. And then you start hearing Nigerian doctors, the way they drag us on Twitter, man.
Are there no regulatory bodies to at least regulate that salary? Because coming from 190 and down to 50,000 naira is, I think it's scary to me, and I'm not a doctor that has to secure someone else. So no regulatory bodies?
Oh, well, can I not go into that? They are actually supposed to be bodies.
Okay.
I don't like to shake some kind of tables. Mm-hmm. Yes, so we can continue that
conversation on social media.
Digital media. How is it helping? Okay, so there's a lot of money in digital media, mm-hmm. if you know how to position yourself properly. I mean, there are a lot of health brands, pharmaceutical companies, health-related brands and products like, I don't want to mention names again, but if you have to get a brand influencer for health-related products, then it should be doctors. Because you get someone who just wants to collect your money. He doesn't care about how authentic that is or how safe it is to the end users. But because you're paying, they will just just take your money and influence that product. Mm-hmm. But if it's a doctor, ethics, all doctors, you know, they live and they work with ethics. There are some products I would never influence, you get. So, but when you have actual doctors influencing, then they can actually give you more value, and then whilst doing that, they're educating the public and also earning money on the side for themselves. There's a lot of money in health influencing.
Okay.
There's a lot of it. One time I was invited to an event to live tweet, and for every day I was there, I was paid 200,000 naira. I was there for 4 days, 5-star hotel, a lot of food, a lot of exposure, and then it was for 4 days, 4 times.
200,000, 800,000,
and they paid for my transportation, and I was just there, practically just doing what I love to do.
I think Ben is thinking of becoming a doctor, but
no.
So how would you advise a doctor that is coming out of medical school, right? That's what you guys call it.
And
they're done with NYSC, and they want to use digital media to at least help their income. What would you advise them to do?
I would advise them to make sure they make health relatable. Mm. Because nobody will listen to you if they do not understand you, mm-hmm. and if they do not relate with you. Make it relatable. Reach out to people who are already, you know, in the game and ask them for tips. me, when I see people on social media, I see doctors on social media, and I think that they are trying to do what I'm... I approach them first. I say, okay, I like what you're doing. This is how you can do it better. Mm-hmm. And then in the bid or in while you're trying to be relatable, try not to lose the core message. Try not to be derogatory. Mm. As you're passing the message, don't try... You mustn't be savage. Because, I mean, you have to... First, you are a doctor before a health influencer. Mm-hmm. So if a conventional influencer would be savage and, you know, talk to, you know, say whatever they want to say, remember that you are still
a doctor.
Yeah, still a doctor, and there's that oath you have taken. So it also relates to the use of social media. I actually had to take a course. I had already started, but I had to take a yearly course on social media ethics and health advocacy. Mm-hmm. So you have to not cross that line, because you're trying to be, you know, hippie
savage
and trendy and savage and all of that. So it's a good thing if you want to go into it. It's a good thing. And it would really, aside the money aspect, it has taken me places. Mm. There are a lot of places I've gone to. I was at an event yesterday. I've spoken at a lot of events, not because I am a doctor, but because I am the health trainer. Mm-hmm. They saw me on social media. They're like, okay, this person that can actually say, can actually pass the message across. I've been called to speak at, you know, offices where they want to talk to, you know, give health education, and they want to make sure that these people understand, you know. So it just gives you visibility, it gives you income, and then it just gives you a lot, basically. So, yeah.
Okay, I think that's how we wrap up, except you have just one more question.
Mm-hmm. I'm done.
All right, that's how we wrap up this episode of Tea Time. Thank you so much for watching. And remember, like I always say, you can catch up on this episode and all our exclusive content by subscribing to our YouTube channel, Plus TV Africa. You can also watch Tea Time on Auto TV and in London on Ben Television. My thank you, as always, to go to my co-anchor, Benny Ack, and of course, the entire production team. And yeah, my studio guest, Dr. Kel. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
My name is Elsie Godwin. Say thank you for watching, and see you later.